Please welcome Patrick J. Kennedy.
God bless America. Thank you for that story, Greg. I thought you were going to say when we sang Itsy Bitsy Spider. It's been an honor to work with you, Greg. You've become a good personal friend, and I love to serve on the board of Bradley, the oldest child and adolescent hospital in the country. We're proud that it's in Rhode Island, in the first congressional district, I might add. I just want to say to Lisa Yang, you're an extraordinary human being, and we loved your speech. It encapsulated what we need in this country, and that is a passion and a compassion for everybody, and the notion that all of us have a role to play. And you were terrific, and I'm so honored to share this podium with you, as I am with the other awardees. And I want to thank all of the professional leadership in mental health, because we've relied on all of you to move this agenda forward. And we have Kan Onimoto, who's head of SAMHSA, a little-known agency within the federal government that, if given the proper resources and power, could really transform this country along the lines that the video suggested. It could transform our criminal justice system. It could transform our workplace and worker productivity. Can transform education. Who could imagine we'd have an education system that doesn't have mental health as a key component to a child's learning? And it could transform our healthcare system, because how in the world are we providing healthcare in all aspects of healthcare that doesn't include mental health care? I don't know about you, but this seems to me pretty self-evident. But I can tell you, in the nearly 25 years that I've been doing this, starting in the state legislature, I've never been more excited about the possibilities to actually achieve this than I am now, with the prospect that we could have an administration led by a person who has made children and families her life's mission and goal. And I can say, having spoken to her a lot about this issue, she has talked to all of us about the fact that in her first year as president, if given that opportunity, she is going to host a second White House conference on mental health, keeping in mind the first one was hosted by her husband. I'm sure you can't think of who I'm talking about right now. Trying to keep politics out of this. What an exciting opportunity. And she gets that it's all about following the money. You know, we can't do this by grants. We don't treat cancer with grants. We treat it with superb reimbursement rates, just like we would with cancer and cardiovascular disease. We pay for this. We would have Medicare rates for high-need categories in mental health. This would be what I would ask her to do, to propose to Congress, if we truly want to reform our system. When 50% of all mental illnesses happen by the age of 14, and 75 by the age of 24. This is a young person's illness, and the way we avoid disability, very simply, is do what we do in every other area of medicine, and that is practice an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. Intervene early and change the trajectory of a child's life for the rest of their life, so they don't have to live with that disability. Whether it's schizophrenia and having the early interventions first incidents, wraparound services, why we let anyone decompensate, why we let anyone's illness pathologize, is beyond me. Every time we have one of these national stories about this, I say, there's an answer. Where is Lisa Yang's political will to implement that answer? You could do it tomorrow if you wanted to permanently change the trajectory in this country of those with severe mental illness. They would not be consigned to having to take high levels of medication if you interrupted the illness early on in the cycle. And we're almost to the point where we can begin with biomarkers to preempt these illnesses through intervention. We have this ability and we could do it today. Because the thing that I get most frustrated with, as I'm sure you do, is this notion that this is too big and too complex and beyond our ability to wrap our arms around. No, it isn't. We know what to do. What's missing is the kind of political will that Lisa Yang exhibited in her speech. So I've been asked to talk a little bit about my personal journey and how it is that I came to be the sponsor of a law called the Mental Health Parity and Addiction Equity Act. And as Greg mentioned, I was 21 when I was first elected to office as a state representative in Rhode Island. And then at 27, as the youngest member of Congress, I was elected as well. And then I was elected to leadership as the youngest member of leadership at the age of 31. I just want to make it clear to everyone in the audience that none of it had to do with my last name being Kennedy whatsoever. It was all my good looks and personality that got me so far in life. But I had had a chance to co-sponsor the parity law in Rhode Island, and I figured when I got to Congress, I wanted to also sponsor all the legislation that I had done on the state level, on the federal level. But you can imagine my surprise, because you know, in Congress, the most popular pieces of legislation, you know, they have a long, long list of co-sponsors, and it's usually led by someone who's been in Congress 30 years or more with a lot of gray hair or no hair at all. And they're the sponsors because they're the chairs of the respective committees or in leadership. Hence, my late father, Senator Edward Kennedy, was sponsor of everything important, from minimum wage to overtime to equal pay to safe working conditions. Woo! Immigration reform, everything. So you can imagine my surprise when I thought I'd be lucky enough if I went back to Greg and my other constituents and said, look at me, out of 435 members of Congress, I made it in the top half of the list of co-sponsors. You can imagine my surprise when the clerk of the House said, Congressman Kennedy, no one's sponsoring that bill. If you want to be the sponsor, it's all yours. I don't know what it was about my colleagues that none of them wanted to have a press conference announcing that they were the primary sponsor of the bill with the words mental health and addiction in it. I guess they worried that the press would ask them if they had any mental health or addiction in their lives or in the life of their families. And of course, if you were any public official, that's the last question that you'd want to answer. Because if you answered yes, there'd be 15 more questions about what medication you were taking or on, or when was the last time you were hospitalized, treated, or that of your family. And no one wanted to answer that. And if they said no, that they never had any of these issues, of course the press would know that they were lying. So they were really between a rock and a hard place. But I was fortunate enough, by the time I got elected to Congress, some of my skeletons were already out of the closet. It was already known that I had been in treatment at 17 for primarily cocaine addiction. And it all happened when I was a second-term member of the Rhode Island State Legislature. I represented a district in Providence, Rhode Island, as a predominantly Italian-American. Rhode Island's the most Italian-American state in the country. And my neighborhood of Mount Pleasant was probably about 80% Italian-American and 20% Irish Catholic. And so, and we had competing churches, you know. We had, so when I first ran for office, I ran against an undertaker by the name of Skeffington. You know, his slogan was, he was the last guy to let you down. So I had to, I figured we could split the Irish vote, but I had to win the Italian vote. So there was this restaurant proprietor by the name of Frank DiPaolo Jr., and everybody loved this guy. He owned the most popular breakfast and luncheon restaurant in my neighborhood. So I went to Frank one day, and I'd been one of his patrons for some time as a student at Providence College. And I said, Frank, would you think of supporting me? I want to run for state representative. And he agreed. He was kind of becoming a mentor for me. He always took care of me. So he used to take me door to door, and everybody knew this guy. So we'd knock on the door. I was awkward, couldn't put a word together, sentence together. He'd knock on the door, and people would say, oh, Frank. And he'd say, just a minute. I want to introduce you to the next state representative here in this District 9. And they'd say, oh, I don't know, Patrick. What's he like? And Frank would say, I have two boys and two girls. And Patrick is like my third son. Well, that's all you needed. That was the good housekeeping seal of approval that got me elected. So one morning, my second term of office, I woke up and my chief of staff called me and he said, Patrick, there's a National Enquirer front page. You're on the cover of the National Enquirer. It's a picture of you looking like you were out too late. And the headline is Patrick Kennedy, cocaine addict, my story with him in rehab. And I just, my heart dropped. I thought, this is over. My political career is done. So I went over to Frank because he's like old school and, you know, people, drug addicts were probably not really high on his list of people to love and have compassion for. And he was at his stove and he was stirring his pasta fagioli. You can't make this up. And he wouldn't turn around. And I thought, I'm really in trouble now. And then he muttered, that rat. And I thought, oh my God, he's really upset. I can't understand really quite what he's meaning by that. But then the next words that came out of his mouth made it very crystal clear. He said, do you want me to do something about it, buddy? And then I understood what rat meant. And the only person in my neighborhood worse than a drug addict was someone who ratted on a drug addict in rehab. So Frank said that's the way we were going to handle it. And that's the way we handled it, and I was reelected. So I got to sponsor this bill, but like most people with these illnesses, I never appreciated that it was a chronic illness. I thought that if I'd been in rehab, if I'd seen treatment, that I'd be all set. I was seeing a psychiatrist on the east side of Providence, and until one day, the mayor of Providence asked me, hey, Patrick, why do I see your car parked on, Wabasset Street every single, you know, Wednesday and Friday? That's how small Rhode Island is. Everybody knows each other by their license plates, literally. And so I discontinued seeing him because I was worried about anyone thinking that I was still getting help. Can you imagine? It's like the military. You know, we want them to be strong, and they'll be stronger if they get help, but they're afraid to get it because they're worried that what the impact's going to be on their career. So in any event, I ended up having additional problems, and I would solve them by, in one case, you know, getting addicted to OxyContin. This is before prescription drug monitoring, so I basically had a number of doctors writing for me, and I would shop around to pharmacies all throughout southeastern New England and northern Virginia to fill all these scripts, figuring that it's okay because it's prescribed. You know, again, another delusion. And then I figured I had to do something about it, so I went to Mayo Clinic during my Christmas vacation because I figured no one would miss me during Christmas. Everyone would think I was with my family. That's when I will finally detox and get my life straight again. So I go to Mayo Clinic, and of course I chose Mayo rather than Hazleton because I figured if people did find out that I was at Mayo Clinic, maybe they'd think I had a serious illness like cancer or something like that. Because Mayo Clinic, you don't think of it as a treatment place for addiction, do you? You think of it as, this is the center for real health care, real medicine. And so I went to Mayo. I told them, listen, I need to get detoxed, and then you got to get me out of here. And they said, you got to go down to the edge of campus. We have this building called the Generos. It's, you know, treats the whole person, not only your addiction, but your, you know, compulsion, your spiritual malady and the like. And I said, listen, I don't have time for that. Just detox me. So they said, well, okay. So they detoxed me. I went back to work in January. And for the next 5 months, of course, I had trouble with insomnia since I was off all the opiates. And I thought, well, I'll take something non-addictive like Ambien to help me get to sleep. And one day, after having stomach problems too, I was taking Phenergan and Ambien. I got up in the middle of the night. I drove my car thinking at 3 in the morning that I had to go vote. And I missed running over a Capitol police officer by inches. And then I crashed my car into a barrier. And thankfully no one was hurt. And next morning I got up, and of course, like many mornings, I couldn't find my car. And I was filled with terror and dread as to what would come next. When was the shoe gonna drop? I went to a meeting of the mental health leadership advocacy community because they were all supporting my parity bill. Keep in mind, I'm the champion of mental health, right? And they noticed that I didn't look so mentally healthy myself, but of course no one talked about it. No one said anything until later when I wrote my book, and then they all said, oh, Patrick, you looked horrible. Well, thanks for telling me. At the time, you didn't say a word, but that's the way we treat these illnesses. So I went to the floor to vote. Thankfully, I was saved by the bell. And then I got a phone call in the cloakroom, and it was my chief of staff saying, Patrick, we've got a problem. You got to come right back to the office. So I rushed back to my office, and of course, it was a dizzying array of press reports about me getting a DWI and cover-ups by the Capitol Police, and who ended up driving me home. And then I got the most interesting phone call of all. I got my father called me, and he said, listen, Patrick, I've seen the press reports, and I saw the TV coverage. Your car doesn't look so bad. You know, in fact, it looks to me like nothing but a little fender bender. That's a Boston accent for fender bender. I think you'll be all right. And of course that, you know, epitomized the kind of family that I grew up in. If you can't see it on the outside, it's not there. In his worldview, this was just a fender bender, and it wasn't much. Forget the fact that I was dying inside. This is a fatal illness. We all were well acquainted with this illness in our family. My mother had a debilitating disease of both depression and alcoholism. And her mother died at the age of 61 and wasn't found for a week. Her alcoholism was so bad that she had alienated my grandfather and her daughters. And like most people with this disease, had really isolated herself. And of course, people who have these illnesses don't want any help or anyone around them. And of course, people around these people don't want to be around them. So you've got a kind of perfect storm to have people isolate. And that's really the true characteristic of this illness. And that's what I talk about in my book, A Common Struggle, is the common struggle is the silence around these illnesses. My father would have the leading policymakers of our nation gathered at our house. And in the middle of a meeting, my mother would, you know, shuffle through the house, absolutely inebriated, in the middle of the day, and no one would look up. You'd have future Supreme Court justices who worked for my dad. You'd have future leaders in all areas, CEOs of major networks, and all of whom got their start working for my dad. They'd all be in our house various times. They'd all see this, and no one would say a word. And of course, I couldn't wait, along with everyone else, especially my dad, for my mom to go back into a room and shut the door so that we would be saved from further embarrassment. That's how we viewed this, as an embarrassment. Forget the fact that she was suffering from a biologically, genetically based illness that was claiming her life, and all we could feel about it was embarrassed. And, you know, it was something when I also ended up having this illness myself, and even my brother and sister both suffered from it as well. And I couldn't believe that this was the nature of it, where we all kept it secret, even though we had grown up keeping these secrets. And that the real irony of all this is that I wouldn't tell my psychiatrist what was going on in our house, because I was afraid that he might tell somebody. Even though you could go to any bookstore in America and read about the very things that I was terrified and ashamed of telling my therapist about. So here I am, from one of the most public families in the nation, where everybody knew our secrets. But I had to still keep the secrets. And of course, like any other family suffering, the secrets, you're only as sick as your secrets. And I was very sick. So when I ultimately started speaking out on this, it was after this DWI, and I had finally went back to May. This time I went down to the Generos building and got all the wraparound services. I came back and all my constituents were calling on me to resign the office, and I decided to run for re-election, and I decided to talk about this everywhere I went, much to the chagrin of my staff. My staff would say to me, "Patrick, they already know about it." Believe me, it's been on the front page of the papers every single day since you've been away. I'm like, okay. So I would show up at community events like my senior centers. We had a lot of elderly in my district, thank God. And most of them lived in high rises named John F. Kennedy, thank God. We called them the Towers of Power, because there'd be elevators, they could come down in the elevator and there'd be a big picture of John F. Kennedy right in their community room. And of course, I strategically placed my picture right next to John F. Kennedy, and the polling machines would be lined up, and basically my opponents had no chance whatsoever. But I would go to these senior centers and I would say, first of all, let me thank you for all those get well cards you sent me while I was in the hospital. And of course, they'd all look around like this. I didn't send them a get well card. Mildred, did you send them a get well card? No, I didn't send them a get well card. Lisa, you didn't send them? But it got everybody thinking that these are not illnesses that we have much compassion for or send people get well cards about. But invariably after I spoke, I was deluged with people who wanted to talk to me over here. And I'll never forget this senior citizen from Warren, Rhode Island, who took me aside and said, "You know, Patrick, I'm on Prozac." I'm like, "Fine, that's great. I'm happy for you. the stories that I got over and over again. So I kind of felt like this thing was resonating, like that people were finally able to talk about it in a way that they hadn't. And when the election day rolled around, I'll never forget being in front of a polling place and seeing this guy who I knew absolutely hated me because of the radio talk shows and he always were on there complaining about me, coming up to the polling place. And of course, I tried to like pivot over here so I wouldn't have to look at him as he was walking into the polling place. And he tapped me on the shoulder and I was like, oh my God, I'm gonna get it now. And he said, you know, Congressman, I hate everything you stand for. I'm like, okay, I know, I know. You people think you're entitled to office. Okay, okay. And so, but I'm gonna vote for you. And I just heart dropped. I couldn't believe it. He said, because I've got addiction in my family, and someone needs to be in Congress who really understands this. And that was 10 in the morning, and I knew that I had that election won at 10 in the morning, in spite of all that. And the irony of all of it is the election following my DWI, I got the biggest plurality of a victory than any one of my elections in the history of me running for office for Congress. And so I ended up going back, and it was the following session of Congress where we actually passed the parity law. And another irony of all ironies is that due to the tragic death of Paul Wellstone, my late father, who was chairman of the committee, decided to take Paul's place on the Wellstone Domenici Parity Act on the Senate side, meaning I had to negotiate with my dad, whom I never talked about these issues with, about what was going to go in the mental health parity law and whether in the House we were going to be able to add addiction, depression, anxiety, and post-traumatic stress, all the illnesses that our family suffered from, my dad suffered from, having seen his brothers brutally murdered and never spoke about. Whether that was going to be part of the parity law, because keep in mind, a lot of folks said, well, the best we can do is try to get the biologically based disorders covered first, and maybe in the next few years we can come back and add all these other illnesses that no one really believes in. And I mean, God bless Pete Domenici, he was a champion for his family who had suffered from severe mental illness. He didn't want to have anything to do. He said, we don't want to add those addicts to this bill. That's going to be the poison pill. We'll kill this bill if we add addiction. And so we had kind of a stalemate. And we had the bill on the floor in the House. I'll never forget my dad walking over and sitting on the floor of the House, because you have reciprocity. I could go over and sit on the floor of the Senate, which always got him like wigged out when he saw me sitting on the floor in the Senate. How did you get here? But you have, if you're a member of Congress, you can go to either chamber. So he sat there and after our bill got heard, he said, you know, Patrick, keep it up, because we're gonna be able to get a stronger bill if you keep pushing this. And that was the ultimate miracle of my dad, as he always was trying to get more, but he always was trying to get what could pass. He then got brain cancer and was at home convalescing, and it was the end of 2008, and our bill, H.R. 1424, the Mental Health Parity and Addiction Equity Act, was on the desk in the Senate. It cost $14 billion, according to the GAO, in the first 5 years. And so there was no pay force that we can find. That's tax extenders. I'm giving a lot of legal jargon for how bills get paid for in the Congress. So we're really stuck. Of course, you remember in the fall of 2008, our banking system collapsed. Our economy was going down the tubes. And there was a piece of legislation introduced in the Congress to shore up our whole financial system and it represented the largest federal bailout of our banks in our nation's history. I mean, you know, Franklin Roosevelt couldn't have dreamed of passing a bill with this much money in it. And it was called the TARP, the Toxic Asset Relief Program. $700 billion. So we first tried to pass it in the House, and we didn't, and the market just tanked even more, just dropped like a rock. So all of a sudden we said, okay, we hate this bill, but we better pass it because we're going to go into another Great Depression. We were really on the precipice there. So we came back. I knew that in the fall, once we passed this TARP bill, we were all going to go home and run for re-election. It was it. That was done. There was no way we were going to pass the parity bill afterwards. So I called my dad and I said, what do you recommend I do? He said, well, call Chris. Well, Chris Dodd was my dad's replacement on the health committee. But as many of you may recall, he was also chairman of the banking committee, a very important committee at this particular juncture in our history. So I called Chris. I said, Chris, can you help me get this 1424 off the desk and passed? He said, let me think about it. He called me back after that. And he said, Patrick, I've got an idea. I said, what's that? He said, how about I write the whole TARP bill language and appropriation into your bill, H.R. 1424, the Mental Health Parity and Addiction Equity Act. In other words, your bill will become the TARP bill because we'll amend your bill to add all of this $700 billion. And I said, okay. And so, of course, it sailed through the Senate and the House, and it was on President George W. Bush's desk the following week, signed into law. Bill meant to address the economic depression that we were going into was a bill to also treat the most common disability in America, depression. So, you can't make this up. So my dad and I go to the White House and watch the bill being signed on the same desk that President Kennedy used when he signed the Community Mental Health Act of 1963, which, among other things, mandated parity for federal employees. Can't make this up. It's also the desk from which he spoke to the nation on the civil rights cause, which he said was the moral cause of his time. And he said in that address, who amongst us would trade the color of their skin and be content with those who counsel patience and delay? In other words, if you didn't think it was a big deal that people in this country were treated as second-class citizens simply because of the color of their skin, then imagine what it would be like to walk in their shoes and then think about whether it's okay to go slow on civil rights, because that was what everybody was counseling President Kennedy to do and everybody to do, is go slow on this, don't rush it. And you know what, we're in the same spot today. Everyone says, go slow on this, work this thing out for a while before we actually do it. Amongst us would trade places with someone who is suffering from a debilitating mental illness or intellectual and developmental disability and be willing to wait until we get justice in the healthcare system? Who amongst us? So you hit it when you said about, we got to think about this as we're all in this together and you want to be treated just as you treat others as you want to be treated yourself. So, President Kennedy, when he signed the Community Mental Health Act, said those with intellectual disabilities and mental illnesses need no longer be alien to our affections or beyond the help of our communities. And, you know, kind of what you do in trying to build community supports for people with mental illness and addiction, it's not the quote-unquote medical model, but it produces good medical results if we have community supports like you were talking about in your country of birth when everybody was together and supporting one another for those kids. And that is the kind of idea that President Kennedy was advocating. He wasn't saying beyond the help of our psychiatrists or beyond the help of our mental health hospitals or beyond the help of our pharmaceuticals. He was saying beyond the help of our communities, because he wanted to emphasize this is on all of us to take care of those who are suffering. Of course, we're going to need medical care and reimbursement for that. We're going to need medicine, just like other illnesses, and we're going to need professional organizations. But the concept is, this is not their purview. This is our purview as a nation. That's the message we got to get out to America. This isn't about some special interest group trying to advocate for more reimbursement for their cause. This is about taking care of America's future, because it's all of our kids who could benefit from a stronger community-based mental health system that could build a stronger future for our country. That's how we make America great again. But we have to overcome this idea that it's something other than healthcare. And that's why I have branded this parity registry, which is I hope you all will take advantage of when you get denials for your patients. Right now, it's absolutely impossible to fill out an appeal, go through internal, external review, to try to hope that within a year, you can ultimately get care paid for that should have been paid for anyway. I mean, the insurance industry is counting on you getting fatigued and, you know, putting so many questions in front of a patient and their loved one, an advocate, they're just gonna throw their hands up and give up. They're counting on that. And so we have no way of truly monitoring how many denials because of more onerous medical management practices, fail first, pre-authorization, concurrent review, retroactive review, how many times we're gonna face those because we don't have any measure. So I hope I can get my colleagues in the professional organizations, both APAs, National Council of Behavioral Health. I'm currently working with the Iraq-Afghan War Veterans of America, who started this concept when they had the weight we carry. And they had, you know, the Wounded Warriors, when they had the guy on the back of the weight we carry, but they spell it W-A-I-T, the weight we carry. And it was begun after the Phoenix Hospital VA debacle, when veterans couldn't get access to disability claims in time, and they found out that they wanted to get a survey of all veterans in this country, how long it took them to go to their VA and get their claims adjudicated. We're working with them to add a page to say the weight we carry for veterans who are denied mental health benefits for their signature wounds of war by their employer-sponsored health plan. In other words, their private health insurer. Because I guarantee you, the way we get United to change, Anthem to change, Humana to change, Cigna, is we say to them, we got a handful of these veterans who were in your plan in Kentucky, Florida, West Virginia, Colorado, California, whatever, and they can't get access for their loved one or for themselves for this care. What are you gonna do about it? Because I know they're prepared to stand in front of your headquarters and say, why not me? Now, I can tell you, having been in this business a while, that's the kind of way that we finally get insurers to pay attention. Because honestly, they are counting on us sitting back on our hands saying we can't do anything about this. We only need a handful of patients with compelling stories. But of course, because of the shame and stigma, no one's willing to share their story. So I can tell you, no matter how many we get, I can multiply that by a, you know, exponential factor and say this represents this many in true form because of all those that won't do this. These people had the courage to stand up and say they were denied care, and they ought to be someone that indicates you need to investigate that insurance company selling insurance in your market. And that's the job of the Attorney General. Now, here in New York, we have Eric Schneiderman, who's done a brilliant job in enforcing the mental health parity law, so much so that last week he got Cigna to end all pre-authorization on medication-assisted treatment, given the And what we want to do is be able to go to each attorney general in your respective state and say, hey, listen, you got to investigate this, because that will get the insurance, you know, company's attention, not a bunch of individual appeals. But if we collect them all and then go to the AG, because if the AG not only can get care paid for, but the AG can get punitive damages, which our consumers, patients can't get. They have right of action that's very limited to just care. So Frederick Douglass said it best when he said, power concedes nothing without demand. Never has, never will. We need to demand that we implement the mental health parity law. And when we demand it, we're going to supersede all these anti-stigma campaigns. Because we've got a law that needs to be enforced, just like the civil rights law. It doesn't matter when we still have people who are racist in this country, who are prejudiced, who are bigoted. Thank God we have a law on the books that protects individuals in this country from discrimination. In other words, we've outlawed acting in a discriminatory manner. So we may not change people's minds about whether this is a real illness or it isn't. I don't frankly care, so long as they follow the law. And that means no more separate and unequal treatment, because that's essentially what we've got today. So we're working closely with David Satcher, the Surgeon General who wrote the Surgeon's Mental Health Report, and we are making this a cause. We're working with Morehouse School of Medicine, you know, the home of Dr. Martin Luther King, our great civil rights leader, and we're going to go around and we're going to invite these insurance companies to come to the Museum on Human and Civil Rights every year. Let them walk in and see all the discrimination in its many forms around the world and in our country. And let them understand that their discriminatory practices against those with mental illness are just those discriminatory practices against human beings, where they're denied respect and dignity that you talk to them. That, I think, is the mission of this parity registry, and I'm happy to retrofit it to AACAP, to both APAs. They can do collect their own data from their own members, and we could work that all out with software, folks, but the bottom line is we got to come together, and if we have some political pressure, we can begin to make changes that will help us deliver the kind of care we know needs to be delivered in this country. And when we start having to pay for acute care, which is what we're going to have to pay for, maybe someone will say, hey, there's got to be a better way than having to pay for all this, you know, tragic acute care, because we're waiting for these illnesses to become stage four illnesses before we even begin to treat them. Maybe it makes sense, and it'll cost us less to go upstream and start to treat a child's ACE scores for adverse childhood experience. Maybe it's about time that we have an annual screening before school that tests kids ACE score. Maybe we start to intervene early, because if we don't, this is going to be a burden that continues to grow because of neglect and indifference. So all I want to say to all of you is keep fighting the good fight. You're not paid what you should be, We need CMS to have commensurate reimbursement as they would for an oncologist or a cardiovascular specialist. We need to encourage insurance companies to pay so there's no more narrow networks. And we need to reimburse for the telepsychiatry and consult collaborative care that we all know will leverage your unique knowledge as specialists in this field to impart that to primary care docs and other physicians who are going to do a majority of the care, but have really no guidance from all of you as to what that care should look like. We need to pay for that. And I am telling you, I'm excited because I think we're going to have a president that is going to reimburse for these things and push this agenda forward. So, Robert Kennedy, in an address in Cape Town, South Africa, when he spoke to a group there who never thought they'd ever see the end of apartheid, said this. He said, each time a person stands up or acts to improve a lot of others, they send forth a tiny ripple of hope. And coming from a million centers of energy and daring, those ripples can create a current that can knock down the mightiest walls of oppression and resistance. And to your point, Lisa, if each of us does our part, and all of us work together to make it just a little bit better, we ourselves are going to write the history of this important time in the mental health movement and ultimately be able to change the trajectory of these diseases by doing what you all know to do best, and that's intervene early and treat people with care, respect, and dignity. Thank you very much.